Hi, everybody. It's Kathleen with the NOLI, and I'm so lucky today. We all are lucky that we are getting to talk to Tracy Corder, who is a graduate. You disappeared for a second, but now you're back. People in NOLI year five, the quintessentials, will remember Tracy for many insights, many deep insights, many beautiful ways of challenging us around racial equity and racial justice, and also as being the person who introduced us to Werewolf. So your face has mentions. Yeah. And when you came through the program, you were at the Center for Popular Democracy, and now you have a new job. So I'm going to let you talk about that in a minute. You can bestow upon everyone what is your new place and what you're doing there. But before we get there, first of all, how are you doing?
You know, we were talking about this. It's such a loaded question. It feels like this year has been, I think we said this all the time, like, oh, this is a horrible year, but going from the pandemic into what's happening now is really hard and really sad, but also I'm trying to find some hope in it because of the ways that we see people coming together, the solidarity we see in the demands that have once been looked at as radical are now being looked at as common sense. And so trying to find hope, but I think how we doing comes moment to moment.
Yeah, that really resonates with me. And I have to say, probably I'm not alone in coming to work yesterday with a very heavy heart and feeling very raw about processing just what had happened over the weekend. And then someone put on Facebook, your Black colleagues are not okay. And when they say they are, don't just move on. And that really, I really held that, you know, to really remember that the trauma that we're seeing and how it weighs on all of us is very heavy. And then on the members of our community who are very, very close to the harm or experiencing the harm in a daily way, it's a whole other level. So lots of love to you.
Yeah, I mean, I've been having that conversation with a lot of friends because, you know, obviously my folks are the people I know have been out and on the front lines, yeah. And I'm watching videos. And I have found myself that every time I have a conversation, we end it with, I love you and be safe. Mm-hmm. And then I also like was struck by the fact that that's kind of how we always talk to each other, mm-hmm. Because the trauma that people are who are not Black are hearing and experiencing, it's new, but this hasn't been new for me. When my nephew that's got right. his driver's license, I said the same thing. You know, when my friends go to other protests, I said the same thing. So it is true that. I've not been all right. I've been trying to practice that actually, even, you know, as the pandemic was going, to not say I was just fine. Mm-hmm. But it's also not new, feels more pronounced.
Mm-hmm. Well, it means a lot to me that you would have time and just emotional energy to be with us today. And I feel like having the rest of the NOLI community be able to understand your perspective is really, it's a huge value for the work and for the things that we both care about. So I just really want to appreciate you for making space for that. Okay, what I know, the little bit I know about your work at CPD is that it was so directly connected to what we're talking about right now, mm-hmm. really focusing on police brutality and accountability, over policing of Black communities, and then working with coalitions to push cities to invest more in what prevents violence, like good jobs and healthcare and community services, and not just keep investing more and more and more in policing. So, I mean, that to me is like, so you, of course, you saw it before the rest of us who are coming to understand it better now. You were already ahead of the game in terms of understanding how the consequences of policing are playing out. And so just tell us, like, what are you seeing now? How does it relate to the work you were doing at CPD? What are your coalitions saying? I'm sure you're still in connection with those organizations. And how are they connecting to this moment?
Yeah, I mean, so, you know, the Invest Divest, which is the work I was working on at CPD, came directly out of a movement for Black Lives Demand. And so we're seeing them continue to lead on work that they've set the groundwork for. And it was really like this idea that budgets are moral documents, and we know that. And we know that they say everything about what we value. We've seen that through the pandemic. we've seen that we have not valued communities enough to give them the proper PPE that they need for healthcare professionals to be safe. But we were easily able to like mobilize National Guard to protect buildings. And so it's really this idea that we were seeing playing out, that there is more than enough money for communities to be protected. It's about how that money is spent. And so if we were able to invest in the things that we need, good jobs, healthcare, after-school programs, good schooling, we wouldn't actually need police presence in communities. And I think that's been a demand that's come out for generations, and it's something that we're able to say louder, and it's something that we're able to say even louder now. So it's really been hard to see everything happening, but very heartening to see that this is becoming a demand. It is becoming what we're standing on to say that, look at this, look what we're seeing in the streets. Like, this is not safety. This is not what this is supposed to look like. And we are now at a point where we're saying, no more police officers kneeling with protesters, no more, you know, asking people to walk hand in hand. Like, if you want to be in solidarity, like, give us your budget. Mm-hmm. And that's been really important.
Mm-hmm. I want to mention we have Nicole Porcolis with us. So hi, Nicole. I just want to share, because, of course, I talk to all different leaders from different communities, and I'm not sure that everyone is understanding how much of what's been playing out in the past week has to do with police escalation of what would otherwise be peaceful protests. Mm-hmm. And I've seen that in my community. Like, we've had very peaceful gatherings where there was no looting, there was no violence, and then the police tear gassed a bunch of young people. Or we've all seen the videos where people, the police are pepper spraying protesters who are not doing anything, aren't provoking in any way. So I think it's just really important to name that it's how much police budget, and then it also seems to be some philosophy of policing that is no longer about working in concert to make our communities better, but it's like a militarized force that feels like an occupation of our communities. And I don't know if people aren't seeing that in terms of how the police response to the protests are. I want to just challenge anyone watching this to make sure that you look for that, because the evidence is overwhelming that in a lot of cases, we're seeing very peaceful protests be turned into chaotic scenes where people are being hurt and being arrested and being pepper sprayed. And, you know, there's a journalist in Minneapolis who lost her eye being shot with a rubber bullet. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I
also want to challenge this idea of like what we consider to be peaceful versus violence, right?
Sure.
And so this idea that like looting is violent. And one of the things I was challenging earlier is, it's hard to remember that we're in the middle of a global pandemic, and the government made the very, very concerted like decision to not support people. We have been asking people like to cancel rent. We've been asking for testing sites. We've been asking for all of these things that people need just for survival. And the government has chosen not to do it. And then we see that billionaires have gotten richer, through this crisis. Mm-hmm. But the looting that we're focusing on is like what people stole from Target. And really it's like, that could have been what people needed to survive, because we have not been helping people survive. I mean, certainly for the past 3 months, but definitely even before that. I mean, the labor movement knows that we're not paying people living wages. We know that. The labor movement knows that folks are not getting the healthcare they deserve. We know that. And so, if we are going to say housing is a human right and healthcare is a human right, and these things that we need are actually necessities and they haven't been met, who is actually doing the looting? And so for me, that's been really important. The Trump administration passed a tax cut for billionaires in 2017. And that steals more from communities and communities of color than like a few people who go out at night and steal from a Walgreens. Mm-hmm. And so for me, I always want to talk about like what peaceful means, what it means to and what it means to take care of each other.
Yeah, I really appreciate that reframing. And frankly, I think I wanted to bring up the focus on looting, because I think we have to rebut that constantly and reframe back to what really is important about what's happening. Mm-hmm. But I do, when I talk about peaceful and not peaceful, I was thinking more about when people are put in danger and at harm. Mm-hmm. And so much as I've seen most of the protests themselves have not put people at harm. They might put some property at harm, but that's a different, we put a different value on that. And what is putting people at harm is the way that police are engaging, you know, and so the violence is coming at us. It's not what we're doing as protesters. And so, like, one thing
I'm thinking about, sanctioned, and it's being sanctioned by the White House, right?
Yeah.
Like that this is not only how people are behaving and police are behaving, but it's being encouraged by Trump.
Yes. Yeah. And so I want you to help us connect the dots for the labor movement around democracy and the central importance of the right to protest for democracy and how that's important for unions. And just like, how do we challenge unions to get clear about what's at stake here? It's not a window being broken. It is losing our right to protest at all without being met with, you know, oppressive violence. And that if the labor movement doesn't get clear about this in the here and now and stand on the right side of this moment, what is ahead is only worse and worse and worse in terms of the show of force and kind of violent repression that's coming back at us.
Mm-hmm.
You want to add to that?
I mean, that was like very thorough. I will say that one of my favorite, I mean, I learned so much through Nili about so many things. And as much as I challenge folks, like I was extremely challenged by it. Mm-hmm. And I still think about so many of the things and still incorporate them into my work. And one of the things I really think about is like, is the way the labor movement has had to protest in the past.
Mm-hmm.
Every protest that people do that works has been inconvenient.
Mm-hmm.
It
that's
has
the
been
nature
something
of it.
That's
yeah.
Right. That's it's been something that has disrupted. And so what we ask is, okay, let's be peaceful and let's walk through the streets and let's and that's important to show solidarity and support. But that's not how the labor movement has won rights.
Mm-hmm.
And so. I think to like go back and read and really study how the labor movement has gotten to the place it is today, and then think about why you do not think that Black lives need to be able to have that level and beyond of resistance. Mm-hmm. I think about the sit down strikes. I think about all of the things that have disrupted business as usual and how that's the only thing that's made a change. Mm. If people like came to work and only, and it's important, right? Like I've been in unions where we showed up and we've worn the same thing on one day. And that's a show of solidarity, like the same color. And people saw that, but that wasn't the only thing that we did. Like that was a piece of it. And so just making sure that we are extending the grace for people to have the same levels of resistance and listening to people as they talk about what they need.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love you saying if we just went for business as usual, because the whole nature of the labor movement is disrupting business and commerce. And so why are people responding now to what's happening with these protests as if maintaining the business and commerce is the point? The point is justice. And then the rest of the world needs to shape itself around that. Mm-hmm. You have a new job. Tell us about it.
I do. Yeah. It isn't actually too much of a far cry from what I've been doing. I'm working at Action Center on Race and the Economy, and I'm just leading up their policing and Wall Street accountability work. And so it's very similar. I'm working with a lot of the same people. As a matter of fact, I've had two calls today with old coworkers, so I have not gone far.
Feels good. Yeah.
But it's really important work, and it's also really good to be at a place where people are thinking about this deeply, about how to survive in the moment and how to help in the moment, and then how to build what's next. Because you know, like defunding police is something that people don't know. Like we haven't done that, and so like let's think about like what's next and how that looks.
Yeah.
I like to talk about it as if you go into suburban areas, like you don't see police walking the beat. You don't see police come when you call them. Like it's not like a patrolling of suburban areas. And so people who live in cities deserve that as well.
Mm.
There's a guy, he was a founder of Dream Defenders, Phil Agnew. And one day he said, Claire, firefighters don't go around with their axes out looking for fires. Like firefighters don't go out with hoses, like looking to see where fires are to put them out. Firefighters come when they're called. And so why is it that we believe that police should be out looking for crime instead of us investing that money into our community so that we don't have that crime?
Mm-hmm.
And so It's just, for me, that's been really important to continue to tell the stories of why we're doing this, and why it's important and what the other side of it looks like.
Yeah, you're reminding me when Jeff does the triangle thing that's like event, pattern, system, and then how do you intervene? And mm-hmm. people think of needing policing because of events, but you're talking about how do we change the system and make those events not happen in the first place, and it's with right. investment. Yeah. Right. How do you think, or how would you want unions to connect with you in your new role? Like, what are the things you want to ask of our network in terms of how they plug in and be a partner in the work that you're doing?
Well, I mean, I think that there's been a really clear demand and clear ask from folks about like separating like the worker movement from the police unions. Like, there are unions that are affiliated with AFL, and that is not the same as SEIU, right? Like, that's not the same as and as a matter of fact, police unions will protect police officers who harass workers. Right. And so I think that's like a really clear demand that people need to get comfortable with and really sit with and understand why that's important. And continue to show up in solidarity. I mean, we've seen bus drivers refuse to transport folks in, I think, we've seen it in Minneapolis and in New York.
And in LA. In LA.
Mm-hmm. That's a display of solidarity that's necessary. I'm just saying that we're not going to go along with business as usual, and we're not going to allow our labor to be used to harass, police, and surveil people. Mm-hmm. And finding more ways to like plug into that is really important.
Excellent. Okay. Last question, unless we think of some more as we go.
Okay.
We've already talked a bit in this Facebook Live series. I mean, we actually started the series as a way to help our network stay connected during the crisis, and knowing that it's very hard for us to see each other face to face, and we're not in the same gatherings that would like keep our relationships fresh and strong. So that was the starting point. And now the coronavirus crisis, which has many dimensions, and then layered upon this crisis that's coming to the fore around police brutality and also around the right to protest. So I wanted to just see if we could go back a little bit though to something you alluded to around the coronavirus crisis itself. And mm-hmm. so we know that that has hit communities of color much harder disproportionately in terms of health outcomes and fatalities and in terms of the economic impact. So I just want to hear you talk about that. Like, how are you thinking about it? How does it, if anything you want to say about what you're seeing personally, just help us like understand mm-hmm. that as best we can.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the work that has been, I continue to support the work that is being done, both kind of at the congressional level and the local level, but also like giving money to any mutual aid fund I can, mm-hmm. because those are the people who are doing like real work on the ground to actually make sure people can eat and can pay the things they need to pay. You look at Chicago, and you see that the mayor has cut off the schools feeding people in neighborhoods because of the protest. This is egregious. And it feels like, I mean, I am a fan of the Hunger Games, the books, not the movies. Mm-hmm. And I talk a lot about, this was a tactic that when people, there was an uprising, they disrupted supply chains and were feeding people or starving people. And so like really, really thinking about how we are involved in making sure that those things don't happen. There are groups like Masks for America, who have been doing a lot of work about in getting PPE and masks to different sites. So we saw that the government was not acting. And so a group of activists came together and worked directly with suppliers and distributors and got masks to different cities across the country. Like, this is the thing that has been happening, and this is the strength we have when we work together. And this is what we have to continue to see as this happens. I don't know where this ends. I don't know what the next steps are. I think that, you know, if you would have told me 2 weeks ago this is where we would be, I wouldn't have believed it. And I don't know what's going to happen a week or 2 weeks from now. But staying connected, listening to what's happening locally, going out to support if you can, if you have extra money, supporting where you can. Those are the things that are really important, because we know that this... I am nervous, and what I'm working with people to plan for is what happens in 2 weeks when we have another jump in cases. Mm-hmm. Yep. Because people have been together, not socially distancing. This is a respiratory disease, and the police are tear gassing people. That has to have some kind of impact on people's health. And so how are we standing together to make sure that we're not overwhelming, or we're going to overwhelm the system, but like how we support them as we overwhelm them. How are we keeping protesters safe now? So I mentioned Masks for America right now. They're doing a drive where they're actually shipping mask out to protesters. Mm-hmm. So just like staying involved and following hashtags, looking at social media, because that's the way we're able to communicate now, to know what's going on, to know how you can help.
Yeah, I appreciate all of that. And I want to add that we know that some unions, all their workers are unemployed. We know that. And then we know some unions are working more and actually have overtime, or have, because of the nature of their work, that they're either essential or and so how are we making sure that the folks who haven't been impacted in a negative way on the economic level are in solidarity with all the folks in need, and like really see resources getting shifted across our movement? That feels like something that we could be challenging our movement to think about in a more intentional way. In addition to other things you said, masks, support, getting involved, being at these protests. I mean, this is not the time to sit back. It's like, this is the time.
This is the time. And also, you know, for people, you know, grocery store workers who have been frontline workers, making sure that they get paid that way. Yeah. This pandemic has shown nothing. If we don't see anything else, we see that workers who have been paid the least have been the most essential to our survival. And we need to pay folks that way. We need to respect folks that way. And when we call labor has dignity, we need to mean it.
Yeah, I am really hopeful about what the opportunities are of this moment, even though the crisis is nothing anyone asked for. Like, no one would have said, look for the silver lining, because it's a total shit show. But the possibility that we see the value of labor in a new way, that feels very bright to me.
And it requires us to dig deeper and to look and to look beyond what makes us comfortable.
Okay, I want to just say that we owe it to you for all the work you're doing, that we make a pledge to be uncomfortable and to really like step into the places that feel scary and see what that leadership looks like. So that's our charge in the NLLI network. If you're watching this, get with us. Let us know how you're doing that. Tracy, thank you so much. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for being, I mean, I just love your whole class. Of course, I love every class. And I have such a feeling of gratitude for the role that you've played across the way that you've been on the program. And stay safe.
Thank you.
And
you stay safe too.
Yeah.
And I love you
too. We'll see you soon. Don't hang up. I'm going to stop our recording. Okay. Thanks, everybody.